Good morning and welcome to the sixth meeting of the COVID-19 Recovery Committee in 2022. This morning we will take evidence on the excess deaths in Scotland since the start of the pandemic. I would like to welcome to the meeting Professor Andrew Elder, President of the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh, Dr. John Thompson, Vice President Scotland of the Royal College of Emergency Medicine, Dr. David Shackles, Joint Chair of Royal College of General Practitioners Scotland, and Dr. Barbara Miles, President of the Scottish Intensive Care Society. Thank you for giving your time this morning and also for providing the written evidence for the committee. The session will be the first of two evidence sessions with stakeholders on this inquiry before we hear from the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care and Public Health Scotland on the 17th of March. Each member will approximately have 12 minutes to speak to the panel and to ask their questions. We should be okay for time this morning, however, I apologise in advance. If time runs on too much, I may have to interrupt members or witnesses in the interest of brevity. First of all, could I please ask our witnesses to introduce themselves and just say a few words? Can we start with Dr. Thompson, please?
Good morning. My name is John Thompson. I'm a consultant in emergency medicine in Aberdeen. And I'm Chair of the Royal College of Emergency Medicine Scotland and Vice President for Scotland.
Thank you very much. Professor Elder?
Yeah, well, good morning, everybody. Thank you very much for the opportunity to participate in this. My name's Andrew Elder, as you've heard. I'm representing the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh, which is a wide range of specialties, but I myself am a consultant geriatrician in practice. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Dr. David Shackles.
Thank you. Yes, good morning. I'm David Shackles. I'm a general practitioner in Perth, and I'm also one of the joint chairs of Royal College of General Practitioners in Scotland, a membership organisation really promoting quality and excellence in general practice throughout Scotland. And we are allied and work closely with our colleagues in England at the Royal College of General Practitioners.
Thank you very much. And Dr. Barbara Miles, please.
Good morning. My name is Barbara Miles. I'm a consultant in intensive care and anaesthesia in Glasgow. And I'm here as the president of the Scottish Intensive Care Society. We represent professionals working in Scottish intensive care units throughout Scotland.
Thank you very much. Thank you. And first, I'd like to thank everyone, as I said previously, for your submission, but everybody else who responded to the committee's call for evidence. I think I'll start with my first question. I think the first thing that stands out to me is that when the committee launched its inquiry, data from the Scottish Government showed that deaths in Scotland were 11% above the average for that time of year and had been for the average of the last 26 weeks, which I think caused us to be alarmed and that this was going to be a growing trend. Although when we look at the recent data published on the 14th of February this year, it shows that deaths in Scotland are currently 6% below average. Can I ask if anybody has any insight or explanation for this trend? I don't know if anyone wants to put their hand up or come in here. Yes, sorry. Professor Elder. Sorry, my eyesight's failing.
Yeah, well, thanks very much. I think your question highlights one of the main issues here, and that is over what time period will we make or be able to make conclusive judgments about the impact of the pandemic on both total mortality and on what we're describing as, or allocating as, non-COVID mortality, which is much more difficult. We will see, as you've highlighted there, convener, short-term fluctuations, and that's in part due to a phenomenon some people describe as mortality displacement, that some individuals who, particularly perhaps the frail and vulnerable, who may have died in a given time period, die a little earlier because of the arrival, in this case, of a new condition. And so that could explain, in part, a decline in the mortality that you've highlighted at the moment. So I think that fact, that over short periods of time, we'll see these kinds of fluctuations that you've highlighted, and the additional fact that some of the potential impact of the pandemic and the way we've had to management manage it will be only apparent over a longer period of time. There's going to be a lag effect, myself and many of my colleagues believe. We really should be very careful not to draw quick conclusions from this data. We're going to have to wait, you know, a considerable period of time, years probably, to gauge the full impact of the pandemic on mortality and indeed morbidity. Thanks.
Thank you, Professor Elder. I'm not sure if anybody else wanted to come in on that question. Yes, Dr. Miles.
I was just going to agree with Professor Elder. I think the effects on the population of the pandemic and the effects on the health service of the pandemic are long-term rather than short-term, and it's going to take some time to see the full effect.
Thank you very much. I'll just move on to my second question, and this is a question that one of my colleagues did bring up in the private briefing that we had before this morning, that a majority of our respondents who answered our call for evidence did not think there was enough strategic focus on non-COVID conditions and suggested increasing staff and bed numbers. I think we all appreciate and understand the pressure on the NHS over the last 2 years, and you can't just magic up staff and beds overnight. But can I ask the witnesses, is there anything that you think that could be done in the short term to address the backlog when we have so many of the capacity challenges still exist? And also, is there anything that government could be doing in the short term to bolster the health and social care workforce? If I could bring in Professor Elder.
Yeah, thanks. I think you are correct that the key to recovery is capacity, and that is both workforce and facility related, and we cannot magic up either more beds or a bigger workforce. We could, and we're already doing that to some extent with the suggestion of the National Treatment Centres, attempt to separate elective and emergency care better, because one of the factors that contributes to the waiting list issue in elective surgery is the fact that, not just during the pandemic, but in our usual winters in Scotland, we have the unwanted impact of the increase in emergency care, the demands in emergency care, impacting on elective care. And as you know, it's been suggested that if we could find ways of separating elective from urgent care, that might help. And the second thing, and I would highlight this particularly as a geriatrician, is that recovery is a whole system issue. You know, I am interested primarily in the efficiency of our hospitals, but they can only operate at maximum efficiency for either elective or urgent care if we can get people out of hospital quickly. And we have a substantial problem in Scotland. It's not new. We've had it for a while. But we have a problem with what is often called exit block or delayed discharge, enabling people who do not wish to be in hospital to get home more quickly. The solution to that, though, is not simple, in my opinion, because it comes down primarily now to the workforce available for social care, particularly in the delivery of domiciliary care in patients' own home. But these are two issues that could be considered, or have been considered already, actually, to help mitigate the problems. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can I bring in Dr. Thompson? Do you have any comments?
Yeah, thank you. Just following on from Professor Elder's point, and just to expand on it slightly, I think there, I agree with everything he says, and that we know there's a clear relationship between particularly long waits for beds, so patients waiting greater than 12 hours in emergency departments for beds, and subsequent cancellation of elective activity. And I think it's very pertinent that any future strategy of elective care involves unscheduled care. They can't be looked at in isolation. And just finally, in terms of the workforce that would be required to separate elective and emergency care, that is going to be, as Professor Ellis says, one of the greatest challenges, because it's the we have a single workforce, and to separate elective and emergency care within Scotland, we don't have the workforce currently to do that, despite the desire to do so.
Thank you very much, Ms. Dr. Thompson. Dr. Shackles, would you like to come in?
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. I wholeheartedly agree with Professor Zelda's comments about the capacity of the workforce in community care, particularly in the care home sector, which has been a particular problem throughout the pandemic. And, you know, any community care is absolutely necessary. We've had, even pre-pandemic, significant workforce issues in general practice and in primary care throughout. And the pandemic has really just shone a spotlight on that. And we need to be absolutely certain and really look at a good workforce strategy along with the government to try and rectify that. And I see that's actually been highlighted in this morning's Audit Scotland report, making exactly that point that we need to be looking at care in the community rather than relying on sending people into more hospitals, the capacity in which we don't have. When you're looking for solutions for this in the short term, absolutely, it takes 10 years to train a general practitioner, so that's going to be a struggle at present. What we've got to be looking at is adequate retention of the workforce, and that's in all sectors. We cannot afford to be losing anybody to the workforce. We've got to be trying to keep them working in a reasonable level to the skills that they can deliver. The retention is absolutely critical. The other thing that's got to be a good way of winning is actually, rather than having to work more or harder, is to work smarter. And we believe that actually improving the interfaces of care, particularly the interfaces between primary and secondary care, where we can get better pathways for patients that are smoother and more effective and more efficient, can actually make things better, can smooth patients' journey, make them more effective, use less resources, and get people treated in a more timely manner.
Thank you very much. It's very, very interesting. Dr. Miles, would you like to come in?
Yes, I'm going to echo my colleagues. There is a finite workforce in the NHS and healthcare, so health and social care in Scotland. It's very difficult to open centres without denuding staff from the existing workforce in other places, much as that might be desired. And also, I would agree with Dr. Shackles, we need to retain the staff that we've already got. The pressures of the pandemic have resulted in a large volume of experienced staff either seeking work elsewhere or seeking early retirement, and we lose a lot of experience and skills within the workforce when that occurs. So measures in the short term, measures to retain those staff in the workforce, would help with some of the challenges we face ahead.
Brilliant, thank you very much for your answers. Can I move on to Murdo Fraser, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the panel. I wonder if I could start with a question to Dr. Thompson in relation to the written submission you've made on behalf of the Royal College of Emergency Medicine. And I was very struck in that by the comments you make around the impact of the delays in patients being admitted to emergency departments. And you highlight the issues of ambulance stacking. We know there are delays with ambulances being able to attend, and also ambulances queuing up outside emergency departments. And you go on to say that in your estimate in 2021, these delays in admissions equated to over 500 excess deaths in Scotland. Now, that's an extraordinary and extremely worrying statistic. It's saying that, you know, there are 10 people a week dying because they cannot get treatment in time. So can you tell us a little bit more about how you arrived at that figure and what the impact of that is?
Yes, thank you very much for that question. So there's been evidence published in the Emergency Medicine Journal last month and subsequently last year, the Getting It Right First Time Emergency Medicine Report in England that was published in September showed a clear correlation between long waits for beds, essentially patients waiting in emergency departments to the appropriate clinical area, and mortality. So patients waiting longer than 6 hours in an emergency department, the number needed to harm is 1 in 77. So for every 77 patients waiting longer than 6 hours, one will die within 30 days as a result of that wait. For patients waiting greater than 8 hours, it's 1 in 67. So there's a clear association with long waits in the emergency department and mortality. And what the studies weren't able to clarify, but clearly is a much greater problem, is the harm not resulting in death that results from these long waits. In 2021, we had almost 13,000 patients waiting greater than 12 hours, which was a greater number than the previous 3 years combined. And 2021 saw our second lowest annual attendance ever to our emergency departments nationally. So this comes down to, again, a point that Professor Elder mentioned earlier with exit block. So there's exit block of patients leaving the hospital, which impacts on the capacity, and then exit block from patients leaving a crowded emergency department, and it's the weight of these patients that then impact on ambulances being able to unload, because there is no safe clinical space within our emergency departments to receive these undifferentiated, unwell patients, unfortunately, because of the issues we have with patient flow within our hospitals.
Thank you very much, Dr. Thompson. That's a very helpful response. A couple of things I'd like to follow up on, if I may, in terms of what you've said. I mean, clearly there's been a major issue with this. We've had a big problem over the last 2 years with ICU beds being taken up with COVID patients. It would seem to be the case that is now on a downward trend, which is very, very positive. What have you picked up just over the last few weeks in terms of future trends, and would you expect this issue with delayed admission to start to work itself through, or is it with us for the longer term? And my second question, I'll just ask this at the same time to save time. Clearly there's an issue here with workforce. That was part of the earlier discussion in response to the convener's question. And you make the point in your submission that even before COVID, emergency departments were understaffed and under-resourced. But how do we solve this in the short term? Because, you know, trying to recruit, it takes 10 years, Dr. Shackle said, to train a GP. Imagine for those doing emergency medicine, it's a similar time. Even if we started ramping up recruitment, now that's going to take a long time to work through the system. We probably can't recruit from other countries because they will face exactly the same challenges we do, quite apart from the ethical issues around taking medical staff who've been trained in other poorer countries here. So what more can be done to try and address this staffing issue that will help us without having to wait for 10 years for more medical staff to be trained?
Thank you for those questions. To answer to your first question, the issue with prolonged patient waits in the emergency department is not a COVID phenomenon. This has been existent for many, many years. And in fact, in the first wave, when there was a step down from all other scheduled activity, patients didn't wait at all to move from the emergency department because there was available capacity within the hospitals. So this is a chronic problem, and the majority of patients that we see in our emergency departments are non-COVID issues. The college estimates that we are approximately 1,000 acute beds short across the country. And that obviously exacerbates the problem. But this, the issue of long waits within emergency departments is not a new problem. Ambulances waiting to offload is a relatively new problem. And the reason for that is specifically that during COVID, there were quite significant infection prevention and control measures put in, not just in emergency departments, but throughout hospitals, which meant that patients being offloaded to a corridor, which is what would have happened previously, thankfully, was no longer deemed acceptable. So pre-COVID, these patients that we now see in ambulances waiting outside emergency departments to be offloaded were lying in corridors in emergency departments, which was neither desirable nor acceptable in terms of a level of care. So it's really just shone a spotlight on what was happening previously, but with patients waiting to be seen for many hours in emergency department corridors. In terms of the workforce, again, I don't have any quick solutions to mitigate the issues with our workforce. We undertook a census last year that showed we are approximately 130 whole-time equivalent consultants short in emergency medicine in Scotland to provide the appropriate level of care and to have enough consultants for the number of patients that the departments see. You're correct in terms of the time it takes to train a consultant, and there's no quick solution for that. As Professor Elder highlighted, retention, I think, is the key. Our census showed, unfortunately, that one in five consultant colleagues plan to take early retirement in the next 5 years, and one in two, so 50%, plan to reduce their hours within the next 4 years. So we have significant workforce challenges currently, and they are only going to increase over the next few years, unfortunately.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Thompson. And just one more question, and I'm happy to open it up as well to other members of the panel to get their perspectives on this. Well, you talked about the importance of retention of staff. Anecdotally, we hear that there's a huge issue right across the NHS with burnout, with those who've had lived through the last 2 years with COVID, and that has probably accelerated the trend of those seeking to take early retirement, for example. Would that be your perspective on it? And if so, you know, what practical steps can be taken by Scottish Government and the NHS to try and ensure people are encouraged to stay on?
I can come in first that before my colleagues. Yes, I think whilst I haven't seen a significant number of colleagues leave the specialty over the last 2 years because of the pressures, I think not just in emergency services, throughout the whole health and social care system, I think everyone is under the same pressure and feeling the same degree of stress and intensity in terms of what has happened over the last few years, which is really just opened up to everyone's knowledge the issues that the NHS was dealing with prior to the pandemic.
Thank you. Professor Elder, I think you were hoping to come in.
Yes, thank you. My microphone was muted there. Thanks very much. If I may make a couple of points in relation to your first question, first of all, the first is that although the focus of our discussion today is primarily around mortality, the impact that the pandemic has had on mortality, in considering the impact of waits in at the front doors of our hospitals, we've got to bear in mind too the huge impact that has on other aspects of the quality of the care that we deliver. It's alarming, as you've pointed out, if it does lead to excess or deaths, but also it's a tremendously detrimental to the overall well-being of patients and indeed their families have to wait to get, in the way it's seen, properly into the hospital. So, and in fact, in our whole discussion, although we're focusing on mortality, the impact of the pandemic, we've got to be seeing it in lots of different ways. And the second issue I wanted to comment on was the whole issue of international recruitment as a potential short-term supportive measure. I don't believe we should disregard that for a number of reasons. That you are correct that the medical workforce issue is a global problem, and you are correct that there can be so-called ethical concerns about a relatively wealthy country like Scotland absorbing doctors from other countries that may not be so well placed. But I think we have to remember that training and experience in Scotland is still very highly regarded by international colleagues. Our college is an international college, and I hear this all the time from colleagues. And I think there are a number of systems available that can be developed to enable particularly trainees who do have a role in service delivery, to come to Scotland to work for short periods of time and then to return home to their own countries. Because it's worth bearing in mind that many trainees in many large countries around the world, for example, India, cannot access high quality training. So I don't think we should give up or disregard international recruitment at all. And then the second point about retention of staff, you know, I think that you know, anecdotally in speaking to many colleagues, that is a great worry. And the point I really wanted to make is it's not just about colleagues who are, you know, more senior, who got the option of maybe taking early retirement. As international travel opens up again, I worry that some of our trainees, again, may start to say, well, I'm going to look elsewhere myself and go and work there. And I think from many of their point of view, it's about things like, you know, respect and value of them in the workplace and the messaging that they get in the media and from politicians indeed about how much they're respected and valued. It's about things like access to somewhere to rest when you're on call, to hot food. We've had the story in the media lately about the accessibility or otherwise of period products in Scottish hospitals. So there are some actually quite basic things across all of our hospitals that we need just to focus on more, that make our trainees, I would suggest, just as much as our consultants, feel that they really truly are valued and therefore will be more likely to remain a part of our workforce. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Can we move on to Alex Rowley, please?
Thank you, Convener. And good morning. Could I begin by asking a question around data and the availability of data? So earlier this week, we learned that there are waiting times for people who are on NHS waiting lists. There are 680,000 people, so one in eight Scots are on an NHS waiting time. So in terms of that data, is it possible to determine any relationship between a person's cause of death and whether they were on a waiting list and whether that related to it? So if we want to understand excess deaths, how do we understand the impact of people being on these waiting lists that are unacceptably high? Could I perhaps ask Dr. Mills if you were able to comment on that?
So it's not precisely our society's area of purview, but it's some of the people on waiting lists are for long-term chronic conditions and some are for more acute. So teasing out that difficulty, in my view, would be quite... Teasing out whether there's excess mortality related to all of the people on waiting lists, I think, would be quite difficult. One of my surgical colleagues would probably comment on that in relation to certain kinds of surgical procedures and the physicians in regards to long-term health conditions.
Professor Elder, would you be able to comment on that, about being able to collect the data and understand the impact of these large, massive waiting lists?
Well, you know, first and foremost, I would agree with Dr. Miles that trying to connect period of time on a waiting list with what we'll call excess mortality would be very, very difficult. And I would, and particularly in the context of the pandemic, and as I said at the beginning there, I would suggest that we don't jump to quick conclusions about it. The other point I would make harks back to what I've just said, and that is that whilst it's important to consider what you're asking, which is, does a prolonged wait for an investigation or a procedure increase mortality, these prolonged waits have impacts other than on mortality. I think we all understand that if you're waiting for, let's say, a knee replacement, it is unlikely that that will lead to your premature death. It's possible, but it's unlikely. However, you have the burden of the disability and dependency that goes along with having advanced arthritis of your knee and you know, the pain and suffering that may go with it. So there are drivers other than excess mortality to make us push to reduce waiting list. Thanks.
Okay. Thank you. And can I turn to Dr. Shackles? And could I ask, I noticed in the written submission that there is a recommendation here in terms of general practices is to increase the support and care that GPs and their teams can provide for those patients with mental health. Clinicians should be made available to all GP practices. One of the outcomes of the lockdowns and 2 years of COVID has certainly been reported as increases in people's mental health, and no doubt GPs will be seeing that. So what is the current position? And also this question of integrated joint social care boards, is that integration actually leading right down to the medical practices where you have mental health services, social work services? Are we seeing that level of integration across Scotland, or is it patchy?
Thanks. I think that's interesting questions about all of those topics. And I think I'd have to say it's patchy. And unfortunately, during the pandemic, it probably became more patchy. The provision of those services started off with good intentions, and then during the pandemic, some of these services ended up being withdrawn. Certainly in my own practice, we do have a mental health worker who is very well used, but I'm aware that other practices do not have that service, and that's greatly to the disadvantage of the patients, but also to the GPs themselves. So we need to increase that provision, make sure that it's embedded within the practices, and make sure that patients know how to access those services as well. That's one of the other difficulties we have, is sometimes patients navigating the route into these services effectively so they can get them in a timely manner. Absolutely, we need to see that improve. I don't yet believe that we have got good enough integration at the health and social care level, and I think we need to work harder with that. Both with our social work colleagues, and that is one of the things we hope to gain from GP cluster working, which was again starting to become more effective as GPs and their teams could integrate and work better with social care and local authority colleagues. Unfortunately, the pressures of the pandemic have rather put that on hold, and we hope that can be brought back and returned. I mean, I think as well, if I might just comment about the previous point about waiting lists. One of the difficulties that we have in general practice is with the increased number of people on waiting lists, we do end up seeing people again and again, either returning because their condition has been worsening, either pain of their arthritic condition, or because clinically they've been deteriorating, putting increased pressure on ourselves. And also then we have to work out how best to prioritise patients. If they do need expediting and putting up the waiting list, that becomes very difficult, and getting back into the system. So what we don't want to do is create a revolving door when we're just seeing people who are on the waiting list, when we've got then new people with new conditions coming in as well. There's increased burden on all of the services.
Yeah, and I mean, that point's the point I'm really trying to get to in terms of the waiting list. It's trying to understand what the impact is and how do you measure that. So the example you give, I certainly know somebody who's on a waiting list to get a hip replacement, and they're in absolute agony, and that is having a wider impact on their health, and makes it worse was one of their friends who was able to put together £15,000 was able to go away and get their hip replacement like that. So you can see that's what I'm trying to get to, is how do we as politicians and as policymakers understand the impacts of 1 in 8 people in Scotland being on an NHS waiting list? I don't know if anybody would.
Yep. If I might just come back on that as well. I think one of the things that we need to absolutely understand is that the data that we have in primary care about the type of people we're seeing, the appointments we have, the both the workload and the workforce available is not good enough. We need much more data about what we're seeing, who we're seeing, the number of people who have repeat consultations, and what they're for. We need to have that to be able to understand it. Some of the data we have from England is we see that it used to be that patients would, you know, maybe consult their GP 3 or 4 times a year at maximum. But now that is going up and up, and we've got multiple people attending over the year, putting increased strain on primary care. So So not only is the population increasing, but people are attending more often. And to the extent that might be becoming unsustainable, we need to get data about that to see if we can help to reduce the need for attendances so we can get people treated more effectively and not having to come back to us all the time. But at the moment, we absolutely understand people are in pain, people are concerned about their health. They come back to us and we try and deal with them as best we can. But we need more and better data.
OK. And just could I quickly return to the point that I think Murdo was speaking about, Dr. Thompson. So my understanding is it takes 11 years to train an emergency department consultant. And even if, and I took the point that Professor made about continuing to recruit from abroad, but given the pressures that are there right now and the massive staffing shortages that are there right now, is there any type of short-term activity that the government should be undertaking to try and bridge that gap between the length of time that it takes to train a consultant and the problems that we have right now?
I think that's a very difficult problem, but I echo some of the points made by colleagues earlier about widening the net and making it easier to recruit internationally. And you know, it's a large marketplace for doctors to work in. So you know, it needs to be attractive to come and work in Scotland, and we should. And not just financially, but in terms of working conditions. So we spoke about well-being and burnout. I think Mr. Fraser spoke about burnout. You know, from an emergency medicine perspective, one of the things that would improve the well-being of our colleagues is actually, reducing the waits for patients in emergency departments. So by improving the system and improving the care that we're delivering to patients would actually That was the main point, that would improve our well-being, not financial remuneration, not improved terms and conditions, actually seeing that the care that we're delivering is improving for our patients. So that's, I think, a very important point to make and to hear. It's not solvable just from a front door, from an emergency medicine perspective, that it's part of a whole system. And we see the patient at the start of that journey in terms of secondary care. But it's a whole system that is impacting on the delays that the patients are facing.
Okay, thanks. And Professor Elder, I think you wanted to respond as well.
Yeah, thank you. I think an additional angle on the workforce issue would be really to consider the role of the consultant, basically. Quite rightly, I believe we've aimed to have a consultant delivered rather than a consultant-led service. And I've already said trainees contribute a lot to service, but that's been an aspiration that, you know, very well-trained doctors, and that means a long time of training, will be heavily involved in service delivery. I don't think it would be correct to move away from that philosophy, but we have to consider what aspects of both the hospital and community doctor can be delivered by other healthcare professionals, and that's already well established and is happening. So to specifically answer your question in the context of my own physicianly background, the physician assistant movement and the development of that profession will help to bolster the medical workforce and deliver some of the services that traditionally have been delivered by consultants. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Was it Dr. Barbara wanted to come in?
Sorry, Dr. Miles, would you like to come in?
Miles, Dr. Miles.
Thank you, I was waiting for the microphone. Yes, thank you. Just to go back to some of the points that Professor Elder and Dr. Thompson have made, I think making Scotland an attractive place to work is not all about remuneration. It's about feeling valued in the workforce. And some, there's been quite a lot of work looking at well-being, of what affords well-being in staff. And some of those points could potentially be addressed in the short term. So what makes a staff member feel valued in the workplace and will aid their retention? It's not always difficult things. Simple rest areas, better transport links, parking, food and hot food potentially are helpful to the staff to make them feel that their workplace values them. And yes, I think developing allied health professionals to fulfil some of the roles that medical staff do will be helpful, but often denudes its other part of the workforce. So many allied health professionals come from the nursing workforce, and when you train allied health professionals to be advanced nurse practitioners, you denude the nursing workforce of skilled, experienced nursing staff. So that would help one area of the workforce potentially cause issues in the other, but I think we would all find that that would be helpful to expand medical working and reduce the workload on the consultant staff.
Thank you. Thank you, Camilla.
Thank you. Sorry, Dr. Shekels would like to come in as well, and then we'll move on to Jim Fairley.
Yeah, thank you. It's just to concur with Dr. Miles's points about workforce well-being. We think that's absolutely essential to retain the workforce and to make it an attractive place to work in Scotland. And we are very pleased to see the workforce specialist service available for healthcare workers to look after their well-being and their mental health. But we do in general practice have great concerns about some of the level of abuse that has been levelled at both GPs and their staff. BMA survey at the end of last year showed that about 88% of practices reported verbal or physical abuse directed either to GPs or members of staff in the previous month, and that's unacceptable. Our staff do their best for the patients and the public. We can't magic up appointments and resources where we don't have them, but to have the staff being abused is just unacceptable. And we feel that's actually those sort of events are having a significant impact on people's retention. People saying, I just don't want to do this anymore if that's what I'm going to be subject to. And we feel some of the narratives that have been propelled both in the media and occasionally by politicians don't help that. Particularly, we feel that the narrative that was circulating throughout the throughout the pandemic, that general practice was closed, was not helpful. And despite media activity by Carrie Luna, one of our previous chairs, that narrative seemed to continue to persist. And the abuse that we got from ourselves and our staff really sapped morale, and I think has had a big impact on how we work and what people are looking to do for the future. And we need to change that narrative.
Thank you. I just want to bring in Dr. John Thompson, who's asked to speak as well.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, it was just to echo the points that colleagues have made around making it attractive to work. I think one of my colleagues mentioned earlier about hot food. There are a number of hospitals throughout Scotland that if you are working overnight, you have no access to hot food or hot drinks. And I think that's absolutely unacceptable in terms of well-being of colleagues.
Thanks very much. Can I move on to Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you, Convener. And thanks very much, panel, for coming along to speak to us today. I'm going to come back to the staff morale thing in a minute or two, but I want to start at the beginning from my own thinking. And this is an inquiry into excess deaths. What do you feel the value of this inquiry is for you as a profession? Nobody wants to answer that one. Just put your hand up. Anyone can jump in. Okay, can we start with David Shackles, please?
Thank you. I mean, I think it's a very good question, this time when we all, as professionals and as members of the public, have been through, once in a generation event. And, one of the things we do value as doctors and medics is evidence and looking at what's happened to us, making conclusions, see if we can make changes and choices for the future. But I think looking at this in depth is really important. As Professor Elder said, it may take some time before we can learn all the lessons and look at all the data, but it's absolutely crucial we do that, so that should future events happen, we're better prepared and know how better to deal with it. But also to open up that conversation with politicians, media, and absolutely with the public about how best our health service should go forward in the future, about where we put our resources, where we concentrate both on conditions that will cause mortality, morbidity, how we manage our elderly, how we manage our care home population, and how we put our resources either into hospital-based services or whether we look actually into community-based resources, and particularly if we can actually increase the focus on prevention as a way of trying to manage our health going forward in the future, particularly with our very ageing population and some of the really significant things that we've seen with dips in longevity. I think it's important that we have these conversations. And that's why inquiries like this are very important, to open up these topics. Thank you.
So let me just come back to you, Dr. Professor Eller. We'll come back to you in a second or two. So from your point of view, Dr. Shackles, is the purpose and the value of this inquiry going to be that it shines a light on the deficiencies that we already had?
I think that would be rather negative. We know a lot of what the deficiencies were. Just going over old bones is not going to be helpful. I think we do have to make sure that we look for the future for this and where we can best look at things. Just criticising what's happened in the past is not going to be helpful to our patients, not going to be helpful to us and to our morale. We might have to look and see if we can learn from the past, absolutely, but just going over it without any thought for the future is not going to be productive, in my view.
Okay, thank you. Professor Elder.
Yeah, thanks very much. I think that we should remember that this pandemic is not over, and the lessons learned from the last couple of years could be ones, if we can learn those lessons, could be ones that we actually have to apply within the next couple of years if we get another variant that has a higher mortality rate than Omicron appears to have had. So I'd be wary of sort of suggesting, and I'm sure that wasn't your intention, that the pandemic is over.
No, far from
And that we're looking way into the future with this. So in terms of the value to the profession now, I've said already that the metrics we choose dictate our policy. So looking at just mortality, you know, isn't the best way to go about it. It's very easy to measure mortality, but as you know, the things that can be counted don't always count, and all that. Curiosity is fundamental to both clinical practice and science. So it's entirely appropriate that everybody is asking questions about this. But this has been an extraordinary 2 years, a major event. And I think it's entirely appropriate that we do look at it now. My final point, I've sort of mentioned it a wee bit already, was that I really sincerely hope that we have, as a society, as a political community, as a medical community, the real capacity to learn whatever lessons this does tell us, yeah, and take them forward, because that isn't always the case. And some of the lessons from the last pandemic, or the one of 1918-19, you know, that were writ large there, we didn't actually apply as well as we might have now.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And thank you for your answer. Your point there about saying that you hope that I wasn't implying that it was over, I'm quite the opposite. I'm probably one of the more cautious people, given what my background is. In terms of the learning the lessons, would it be, and splitting up the elective and the emergency provisions that we have, would it be fair to say that had we had elective clinics already in place, we would have had less excess deaths?
So Sorry, is that to me or
anybody that wants to answer it? You guys are the experts.
I think that the amount of excess capacity that we would have had to cope with what you know what was coming just wouldn't be practical. Wouldn't have been in no healthcare system in the world had the excess capacity available for its elective work, or none that I know of, to take away the displacement of activity that occurs with the kind of surge that you see from a virulent virus. So in theory, yes, but in practice, no. I think that as I said earlier, you've said, is it spotlighting things that we knew already? Well, every Scottish winter for the last 10 years, we've seen the displacement of elective activity because of winter surges in urgent activity. And we should, you know, that lesson can be carried forward into the idea of better separation of elective and urgent care.
Okay, so let me just pursue that a wee bit further. We're planning, or there is a plan to build, I think it's a 33-bed elective care centre in Perth. Had that been up and running and established, the people in my constituency would have had access to that. So we may have not reduced the excess death numbers because we were losing people to COVID and then related diseases, but would it have meant that we would have been able to treat people with those earlier stage diagnoses of cancers rather than them getting, for want of a better phrase, bumped down the line?
Well, as Dr. Thompson, John Thompson said earlier, any new facility needs staff. And remember, we were redeploying staff to support the front door of our hospitals. Yes. So had the facility existed, no, it wouldn't have been able to do what you maybe hoped it would, because we wouldn't have had the staff.
Sorry, can I just bring in Dr. Miles, who'd like to come in on your question, Mr. Fairley?
Yes, thank you. I was just going to agree with much of what's already been said. I think the point of this, the original question, the point of this inquiry, the value to profession, is to learn. And I would hope that we can apply that learning to try and have a slightly more resilient health service. We can never respond to the peaks of activity that the first wave and subsequent waves have had, but peaks of winter activity we might be able to manage more effectively from what we've learned through this pandemic. And I would also agree that we do not have excess capacity to manage peaks that we have seen previously. We don't have the workforce. And the only place where there is activity that can be stood down is generally elective activity. And that's where people were mobilised from theatres, outpatient departments, to help with the acute demands in inpatient facilities. And that service is always going to be vulnerable if we have these ongoing peaks, as Professor Elder says. This happens to some extent, not infrequently, every winter.
Sorry, let me just come in on that. Surely it wouldn't be viable for us to have that level of staffing at all times to cope with a potential peak?
No, it's not viable, and neither are the staff out there to employ.
Sorry, Jim's just really conscious of time. Okay. I have to move on to Brian. Would you please?
Thank you, Gavina. Good morning to the panel. I was struck quite a lot in the evidence that was given around the potential that patients are now presenting with more acute conditions than they were pre-pandemic. Can I start by asking that question? I suppose I could ask anybody that question, but could I start with Dr. Miles, please?
I think I don't have any, I think as a society we don't have actual data on this, but there are certainly anecdotal reports that people are presenting with conditions, chronically comorbid conditions that have not been managed, perhaps as efficiently as they could have been under normal NHS working conditions, and so they present with decompensated disease to hospital more frequently. And there are some conditions that, if they're not managed under the elective programme, will present, as people have said before, they will present to service GP or to hospital frequently as these conditions flare up. There may be some data coming through on cancer presentations, but that may take some time to be interpretable.
Don't know if there's any of the other... okay, Professor Elder, not everybody. Everybody wants in, Professor Elder.
So quickly, thanks. Since our written submission, I've been made aware of one paper in Scotland that I can forward to the clerk, if you wish, that does look at the what we call the acuity of presentation in patients in three centres across Scotland, and they gauged the judged acuity based on the extent of damage to the kidneys and some other changes in the chemistry of the blood, and also early inpatient mortality. So that paper is relatively small, but it's the only sort of peer-reviewed evidence that I'm aware of at the moment, and I say I can make that available. But you know, the strong anecdotal clinical impression is that this is the case, particularly amongst colleagues, I would say, who work in the specialties of diabetes and cardiology and oncology. If we separate, you know, if we mean by acute how unwell you are when you come to the hospital, you can also separate that out into how advanced your disease is, particularly when we're thinking about cancer, when you present to the hospital. And there is, again, I would say, quite a strong but still anecdotal impression from clinicians that and from some pathologists that I'm aware of, that disease cancer is more advanced when it presents. But we're going to have to wait more time to get more information on that. Thank you.
Dr. Thompson.
Thank you very much. Yes, I was just going to, first of all, make the point that Professor Elder made, that there's very little in the way of published data around this. However, within the emergency medicine community, whilst it's anecdotal, there's a clear consensus that emergency departments were dealing with patients who were of higher acuity. Whilst it's normal for patients to be diagnosed with cancer by presenting to emergency departments, a number of patients had a significantly more advanced disease, as Professor Elder said. So there's no data, but there's a unanimity in terms of the clinical professional opinion in terms of the acuity of patients over the last 2 years.
And I don't know if Dr. Shackles has anything he wants to add.
Unfortunately, like the others, we don't have the absolute data to give, but anecdotally within general practice, in my own practice, I would agree that yes, we have been seeing patients who are presenting at later stages, either with their cancers because they didn't present to us, or for other reasons. As Professor Elder pointed out, we have an ageing population with multi-morbidity, and because we've not been able to do a lot of the routine chronic disease surveillance and monitoring, those patients have potentially had deteriorations that, when they have developed some other condition, have made them present in a more acute manner. And we can see some of these elements, I think, as Professor Elder alluded to. Dr. Bernie Kroll from the Royal College of Pathologists has got some good data that I think he's planning to publish about the use of laboratory services down to actual GP levels. And we can see that there was a big drop in the use of laboratory services at the start of the pandemic, and we are just now starting to see the chronic disease bloods and surveillance getting back to a more normal level, which is going to be obviously be helpful as we can monitor our patients more effectively now. Yes, anecdotal evidence, but nothing we can give definitively from general practice.
Thank you, Dale. I think that's very helpful. It kind of sets up the direction of travel we wanted to go in here. And I think it's around collection and analysis of data. And we did a lot of work in the Health Support Committee last term, pre-COVID, around possibly the fact that in Scotland we're behind the curve in terms of our ability to collect data. And I think, you know, that if you're going to approach a challenge, you really need to be able to you know, quantify what the challenge is in the first place. So I suppose what I want to ask really is are the Scottish Government collecting or establishing the or indicators adequate really to establish the extent of the health impacts that are not directly related to COVID-19? Is this perhaps one of the learnings we need to take from COVID in that we need to be better at gathering and quantifying that data? I'll ask Dr. Shackles to start on that one, please.
I think it's a very good question. I think we do need to be collecting more data. We need new systems to be able to do that. We in general practice have been waiting some years for IT reprovisioning or systems that would give us more ability to collect that data. The read coding system that we use in general practice is outdated. We need to move to SNOMED. That's happened in England. It's not happened in Scotland yet. And that would give us better ability to code the medical conditions that we're seeing and to track conditions for that. But for all of these, for data collection, we still need workforce to be able to do that. Data collection in primary care and general practice has been poor for a whole number of years. We're working with Scottish Government and other colleagues to try and improve that, but it's a slow process and it needs to be accelerated.
Are there any other of the panellists would like to comment on that? Professor Elder.
Yeah, thanks. I think doctors in general, scientists, will always want more data. Data requires resource to collect it. And that's, you know, a fundamental decision that has to be made. Do we direct resource to the collection of data or to other parts of our health service? So I think it's a moot point whether we need more data. From the clinician on the ground's perspective, I would suggest that what would be more helpful is the ability to join up the different data sets that we have, mm-hmm. to access it and to be able to apply it to our own clinical practice. You know, we're living in an age of fantastic IT, but still within the NHS, we're not always as well served as we might be with that IT to enable us to use the data that already exists. And thanks very much.
Thank you. I think I'll just finish this line of question, and you kind of got to the point really where I was hoping to get to, Professor Elder, in that the IT system that we currently have, and this is not just COVID, it was pre-COVID, we discussed this at Health and Sport Committee, the IT system that underpins the health service and the direction of the health service is outdated. So I suppose going forward, given this is the COVID Recovery Committee, one of the things, you know, I would like to explore it is this: should we be investing in that IT system that kind of overlays the whole of the NHS and the clinical system, that then in the future gives us an ability to better respond to a pandemic like this, and in general understand what's happening in non-COVID conditions? Dr. Thompson, your hand was up quickly there.
Yeah, thank you. I think, yes, in terms of COVID recovery, but actually you spoke about workforce for data collection. From an emergency medicine perspective, there's three different systems used nationally in different hospitals, none of which speak to each other. And there's a large problem with primary care systems not speaking to secondary care systems. So we can see patients in emergency medicine and are unable to access primary care data, which then impacts on our ability to treat patients appropriately. And the amount of clinician or physician associates or advanced nurse practitioners, but the clinical team spent inputting data into the systems because it's so clunky and dated is phenomenal. The amount of actual clinical time that's lost to poor IT systems that if was improved would increase the amount of clinical time available for patients. So I think not just for COVID recovery, but for the NHS moving forward, that IT has to be a huge focus.
Yeah, I'd actually written down the interface between primary and secondary care here as part of that solution. So And you also highlight there, Dr. Thompson, that there isn't a universal system for the whole of the NHS to access. So presumably then what you'd be asking for is that exactly that, a system that clinicians can, even multi-layered, can access, and that would have a positive impact on ability to care.
Yeah, it's a huge patient frustration when we continue to ask them questions. So the patient's perspective is that when they see a doctor, be that in primary care or secondary care, that we have complete access to their medical records. And nothing further could be from the truth. So I think in terms of improving how we look after our patients, having some seamless access to the patient's medical record, which is becoming increasingly electronic, if not purely electronic, is absolutely necessary.
I think Dr. Miles would like to come in on that question, then we'll move to John Mason. Thank you.
Yes, I echo many of the points Dr. Thompson just made. It's frustrating when you can't get access to information either in other health boards or in other parts of the health service when you're dealing with a patient in front of you. The point about data, I think more data is always useful, but we have to be careful that the volume of data isn't always the issue. It's collecting the right data and using it in the right way. If collecting lots and lots of data is very workforce intensive, but sometimes not all that data is required. So the choice of the data that you're going to collect and then having the ability to analyse it and implement it is very important. So we have to be, I think, more smart about this than we have maybe been in the past. My other point was that the data that we use, I know this panel is looking at excess mortality, but go back to the points that we've made before, is morbidity is very important, and mortality is easy to measure, morbidity is harder, but lots of patients living with excess morbidity is very important to them and also very important to their families and affects the way they live their life and how they function within society. So I think that is also useful data to collect.
Thank you. Can we move to John Mason, please?
Thanks very much, Convener. And it ties in my first question quite well with what Dr. Miles just said about mortality and morbidity. And I was going to ask Professor Elder first in his written paper. It's 5D in the paper. I just wasn't sure I quite understood what you were saying. Consideration should be given to the relative priority of treatment for high morbidity, low mortality conditions, brackets, for example, joint replacement for degenerative joint disease, close brackets, and treatments for conditions with higher mortality. So you're saying there consideration should be given. Are you actually saying we should put more emphasis on morbidity than on mortality?
I'm saying consideration should be given. I think amidst all the various choices that we make about priorities, one quite clearly is whether, and this is what this discussion is actually getting at as well, is whether mortality should be the main driver to our policy, or how do you balance that against what we'll call morbidity just now, waiting a long time with a very painful hip or knee. I'm not suggesting one is more important than the other. I'm suggesting that we should be, if we have to take such steps to accelerate recovery, that one option is for policymakers to make a call on that.
Do you think we as a society put too much emphasis on avoiding death?
I think that a case could be made with an ageing population that a time comes in an individual patient's life, and it's for them to determine and not for us on the basis of their own age. But some individuals definitely, in my experience, begin to hope and wish for a style of treatment that focuses more on their comfort, well-being and quality of life than their longevity. But I say, I think that's an individual decision that we, through initiatives like Realistic Medicine in Scotland, we need to enable patients and their families and their caregivers and doctors to discuss.
Thank you. If I can
take another quote from your paper, although I think other panellists might want to come in on this point. You say, you refer to the United States in 1B about around one third of excess deaths may relate to non-COVID causes. So it was a more general question. I just wondered, you know, are there lessons we can learn from the United States or from some of our closer neighbours, France, Germany, Netherlands, countries like that, about how they've dealt with COVID, and have they dealt differently with non-COVID cases during the pandemic, that kind of thing? Do you want to start, Professor Elder, and then I'll move to the others?
Yeah. I mean, so the analysis in question there is huge in the States, but you know, it and that's what it points to. It points to the fact that there is excess, in inverted commas, non-COVID mortality, and the conditions noted there are those most likely to feature there. Can we learn lessons from the United States? Well, I think the approach has been so different state, and they are still in many states in the US still in much more difficulty than we are due to varying rates of vaccination in particular. And of course, the very fragmented style of healthcare between public and private there makes it very difficult to draw conclusions. So I would say no, there's nothing in particular right now that I'm aware of for the way that the states went about it, the United States went about it, that we can learn from. And I actually do not know about European neighbours, about anything that we may particularly learn. Thanks.
I wonder if any of the other panellists know about other European countries that we could particularly learn from or have done anything particularly well compared to us. I'm seeing shaking heads from everyone. So that's okay.
Dr. Shackles did want to come in on your
previous
point, though.
Right, sorry, Dr. Shackles.
Thanks very much. Thanks very much for that. Yeah, I just want to come in and echo Professor Elder's comments about realistic medicine and the utility of this, but also to make comments about, which may cover some of the data sharing comments as well. At the beginning of the pandemic, we in general practice spent a great deal of time working with our patients, contacting them and constructing advanced care plans. I think at the start of the pandemic, the number of care plans went up fourfold compared to pre-pandemic. And I think that is very useful for the data sharing, but also the ability to have those conversations with individual patients about what their wants are about their care going forward. And one of the things that we're starting to see in general practice is some emerging evidence and some published evidence about this, about the importance of continuity of care in general practice, the actual continuity of care, being the same general practitioner, the same nurse each time, can have a significant effect and improvement on both morbidity and mortality. The only way we can manage this continuity of care is making sure that we've got the workforce able to do that. But we see continuity as being one of the things that underpins what we do as general practitioners. And that, with some of the ways of working, because of workforce, because of the need for very rapid access to general practice, has been eroded away to the detriment of patient care. The continuity is absolutely necessary, and we need to build on that as much as we can to work on some of these things like the morbidity of patients, and also to give us time to have these really important conversations about what patients want about their care. Are they going to be somebody who wants to be treated at all costs, or are they somebody who values just being kept comfortable and looked after, and actually additional treatment isn't in their interest? But those are difficult conversations to have. And we need to be able to share those conversations across the interface as well to make sure that we all know what the patient's wishes are.
Okay, that's helpful. I mean, I certainly remember when I was younger, we saw the same GP every single time when we went to the GP. To move on to a slightly different area, Dr. Miles, in your paper, you talk about resources, and I think that gets touched on in other papers as well. But specifically, you say the health service budget is finite and was under-resourced given the demands before the pandemic. So I'm kind of wondering, I mean, we've already mentioned preventative spend, so I wonder if you're arguing that we need to spend, as a society, we need to spend more on health, and assuming we're not going to cut that off universities or schools, that probably means higher taxes. So is that kind of what you're arguing? Or would you argue more that we should be using money differently within the health service and better within the health service?
Well,
I think the tax question is potentially, and the decision about where resources are allocated and how much tax is raised by the government is generally a political one rather than a medical one. But I think how we utilise the resource that we are allocated also has some degree of political will behind it, but and societal will. So going back to the points that Dr. Shackle made, what we have to do, what is important to society to focus on? Do we want to, if we will always, even if we raise more money, we will always have a finite resource. It's never going to be, you could spend, America spends more on healthcare per head of population than we do and still has not been able to deliver the healthcare to all of its population that it would want to or that population would demand. So it's, money is not the only answer. What we decide to spend it on is important, and it's possible that we may over subsequent years decide to refocus that on preventative care more than acute care, but those are conversations to be had with society and the political parties as well as the health service.
Okay, thanks very much. I mean, I wasn't surprised that you said it was a political question, although I have to say that if people state that the health service is under-resourced, I think that is a political statement, and therefore one of my jobs is to ask where the money is coming from. I mean, Dr. Thompson, kind of in the same area for yourself, I mean, your paper talks about needing extra beds, and yet at the same time, the concept of preventative spend, and a lot of people would say we should give the GPs more money and chop it off the hospitals. How do we get that tension right?
So in terms of the beds, that's what we feel is required for the demands that are currently placed upon secondary care. I mean, I think we need to be looking at different options to hospital admission. We need to be looking at how we can treat patients differently. Colleagues, again, have spoken earlier about community-delivered care and whether that's direction. So we need to look at using the resources effectively and not admitting patients to hospital who can be managed in different ways. Ideally, you know, when you look at the geography of Scotland, particularly closer to home.
Okay, and maybe for my final point then, Dr. Shackles, would you like to come in this one? Does there need to be a shift to primary care and away from the hospitals?
I would say so, yes. I would say that, I think. Throughout my career, every high-level report that's been issued has said there needs to be more of a focus on care in the community, care closer to people's home, and less of a focus on secondary care. But all we tend to see is money gravitating towards hospital services, either in building hospitals or increasing consultant numbers, and less delivered in the primary care sector. So our GP estate or GP surgeries and practices, currently one of the biggest problems that we had was delivering care in a COVID-safe way, because GP surgeries were not, in many cases, fit for practice. They did not have the space or the workflow to be able to deliver it effectively. And that was a big strain because of potential underinvestment, I would say, in the GP premises estate. So yes, I think we need to have a rebalancing. But equally, I'm also going to agree with Dr. Thompson that the number of acute beds available to us probably isn't sufficient. So it's how we square that circle. Over my career, when I started up, for every general practitioner, there was 0.7 of a consultant. Now it's the other way around. We have an inverse pyramid of the number of doctors working in the secondary care sector. And that seems to me to be strange when actually all the policymakers say we should be having the care closer to the patient's home. But if we're trying to look after more people at home, then we are going to need more people working in the community. And there are some initiatives like Hospital at Home where hospital consultants and hospital staff will be involved in that. That's well and good, but other resources are required for that as well. Particularly our district nursing colleagues, or actually social service carers, where we need to provide that the nursing care and the looking after potential carer numbers in the community. So it's complex. I don't think it's just a one thing or the other. I think that would be massively oversimplifying a health service okay. that relies on all of us to be working to the highest level to make it work.
Okay, that's helpful. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much. I am going to bring in Jim Fairley because I knew I cut you short and I shouldn't have because we've got more time than we thought, but we are now short of time. So
no short of time. I'll be very brief, and this is directed to Dr. Shackles. We all stood outside our doors, clapped for the NHS, clapped for the nurses and all the rest of it, but there seems to me to have been a massive turnaround and that you guys have now become the whipping boys in terms of the appalling abuse that GP surgeries have had. I guess that some of that will be that the practices of a GP are changing. The fact that you're now seeing people online as opposed to in person. Where do you feel the GP system is at the moment? Is it going to go back to being all in person? And how do we make it easier for you as a individual profession within a wider profession? How do we make it better? I very much take on board your tracing of patients' information, and I think that's something that we should look at and making sure that the IT system works for you guys. But what else do you need in order to turn that around where you are no longer taking the abuse that you've been getting, which I have to say has been utterly appalling?
Thank you very much for the question. It is very much on our mind, all of those topics that you've raised. General practice and general practitioners and all our staff, all we did throughout the pandemic was what we asked. We applied the guidance that came down centrally, sensible guidance sent out from the Chief Medical Officer, from Scottish Government and for other agencies about public health and the way that we should be working. We haven't made anything up ourselves. We've applied the guidance that have been given. We've been very agile, very good about switching quickly to the remote method of working that we were asked to do, while still making sure that we could see, that we could visit those who were vulnerable, who needed face-to-face appointment. That never stopped. What did stop was the message didn't get through. I think partly the message didn't get through is because so many patients are absolutely used to, over their entire lives, over many, many years, of just walking into their GP's surgery. Very good access. The access we have to general practice in Scotland has been unbelievable over years. And when it was suddenly told they couldn't have it, that it stopped, you got a reaction, understandably, for that. Particularly during the lockdown phases where patients couldn't go out. If you can't see somebody working, you don't think they're working. When they can't see us, they don't know what we're doing. But actually, our members have been working incredibly hard, as I said, making up the advanced care plans, phoning our most vulnerable patients, working out the shielding lists, then starting to do remote consultations by video, telephone, also doing home visits to care homes as well. That never stopped. And then, as we start to open up a little bit more, as patients come up and the demand went up, of course, inevitably, demand exceeded supply. And so patients were told they couldn't speak to us or see us. We're still having to have initial conversations on the telephone, which uses up time, reducing the potential number of face-to-face consultations we have. Still trying to make sure we ask respiratory questions so that we're not bringing down people who may potentially infect other people with COVID who are attending the surgery. So still working to the winter pathways as much as we can. And that's despite Carrie Loon and others fronting up public information films about the changes that we're having. We don't believe that there will be a complete reversion to how general practice worked before. We always did use some video consultations. We always used the telephone. There will probably be a rebalancing. We see it will probably go up in the college to maybe somewhere to around 65% face-to-face, 35 remote consultations. That might be appropriate for that. But there will be some areas where it's different, particularly in remote and rural, if patients find it much more convenient to use some of these new technologies as they get used to them. But patients still value the face-to-face consultations, as do the doctors. It's what gave us a lot of job satisfaction. And that's one of the difficulties that we're seeing in retention, where older doctors particularly are not enjoying the new ways of working. They don't get the same satisfaction from seeing their patients. And they're saying, do you know what, if that's what it's going to be, we don't want it. And so we've got to be very careful about that recruitment-wise and retention-wise, because that's what makes us work well. Absolutely, we've been calling for better public messaging, public conversations for a long time, well into the pre-pandemic. We absolutely needed it now. The problem is some of the damage has been done. People were feeling undervalued, feeling abused, and we've got to regain some of that trust. That's not that we don't undervalue some of the comments made by other organisations, patient organisations, the Alliance. We understand some of the concern that patients have had because they haven't been able to access the GP at the time they wanted or face-to-face. We understand a lot of their distress. We feel we need to work with our patient groups better and ought to get better understanding for that, because we can make sure that patients can get seen when appropriate. But a lot of those points are about resourcing as well as the way we work.
Okay, thank you very much. That is very helpful.
Thank you very much. I know others did want to come in, but unfortunately we have run out of time. I'd like to thank all the witnesses for their evidence and giving us their time this morning. If witnesses would like to raise any further evidence with the committee, they can do so in writing and the clerks would be happy to liaise with you. I will briefly suspend this meeting to allow a changeover of witnesses. Thank you. Good morning. We will now move to agenda item number 2. The committee will take evidence from the Scottish Government on the ministerial statement of COVID-19, 2 monthly reports and subordinate legislation. I welcome to the meeting our witnesses from the Scottish Government, John Swinney, Deputy First Minister and Cabinet Secretary for COVID Recovery, Professor Jason Leach, National Clinical Director, who is joining us remotely this morning, and Dominic Munro, Director of COVID-19 Exit Strategy, and Elizabeth Blair, Unit Head of COVID Coordination. Thank you all for your attendance this morning. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any remarks before we move to questions?
Thank you, Convener. I'm grateful for the opportunity to meet with the committee and I'll make a brief opening statement. On Tuesday, the First Minister set out the revised strategic framework to Parliament. This document details the Scottish Government's approach to achieving a sustainable return to a more normal way of life while remaining prepared for potential future threats from COVID. This approach will support us to manage COVID effectively through sensible adaptations and public health measures that will strengthen our resilience and support our recovery as we build a better future. In time, we will seek to rely much less on legally imposed measures and instead rely more on vaccines, treatments and good public health behaviours. We will continue to ensure the maximum possible availability and uptake of vaccination in line with expert advice. Indeed, from mid-March, we will start issuing vaccination appointments to all 5 to 11-year-olds. We will also begin providing an additional booster to care home residents, those aged over 75 and those over 12 who are immunosuppressed. Similarly, testing has been and will continue to be a vital part of our management of COVID. Over time and in a careful and phased manner, it is reasonable to move away from mass population-wide asymptomatic testing towards a more targeted system that is focused on specific priorities. We will publish a detailed transition plan for Test and Protect in March, by which time we will hopefully have much needed clarity from the United Kingdom Government on testing infrastructure and funding. From Monday the 28th of February, the guidance on how often to take a lateral flow test will change. We will revert to the advice to test at least twice a week, particularly if going to a crowded place or meeting anyone who is clinically vulnerable. Further, the updated strategic framework sets out a number of additional proposed changes to public health protections over the coming weeks. Firstly, from Monday the 28th of February, the COVID certification scheme requiring certain venues to check vaccine status will end, although the app that supports the scheme will remain operational for businesses who want to use it voluntarily to reassure customers. Secondly, from Monday the 21st of March, assuming there are no significant adverse developments, the legal requirement to wear face coverings in certain indoor settings and on public transport will end. From the 21st of March, we also expect to lift the legal requirement for businesses, places of worship and service providers to have regard to Scottish Government guidance on COVID and end the requirement to retain customer contact details. The strategic framework details the kinds of behaviours and adaptations that will be encouraged in different circumstances. These include enhanced hygiene, improved ventilation, increased hybrid and flexible working, and face coverings in some indoor places. It is now less likely that these measures will be legally imposed in the future, but we will advise their use for as long as they help control the virus and protect those who are the most vulnerable. The approach set out in the strategic framework will support us all to return to normality and ensure a safe and sustainable recovery. And I'm very happy to answer any questions the committee may have.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. I'll turn to questions now, and if I may begin by asking the first question. First of all, I think I'd like to thank the Scottish Government for this strategic framework announced this week. I think it's very welcome news for many, the lifting of restrictions later next month. I know there's currently uncertainty regarding the future of testing, but as our framework identifies 3 broad threat levels being low, medium and high, if testing is reduced in considerable capacity, how will it be possible to monitor the outbreaks of new variants to determine which threat level we should be at?
I think I'll bring in my officials to provide some further detail on this, but this is a very material issue, Convener, and it will involve it will involve an ongoing level of testing infrastructure. And I think that's the key point that I would want to reassure the committee about this morning. We simply cannot turn off testing, and it would be a mistake to do so. There has to be a mix, and this is what we will consider as part of the testing plan. a mix between measures such as the ONS infection survey, which is absolutely critical for intelligence purposes on the prevalence of the virus, levels of testing that enable us to reliably gather the basic information that enables genomic sequencing to be undertaken so that we can identify any new strains and new variants. So there has to be a degree of ongoing intelligence about the prevalence of the virus within our society to enable some of the judgments to be made about at what stage are we operating. And there will be more detailed testing required to enable us to form a picture of what, if any, new strains are emerging within our society. So there are almost two different elements and requirements that are necessary in that process to inform our judgments about the state of the pandemic and also to be able to contribute to the international effort to identify any new strains and variants, which it is our absolute duty and obligation to participate in. And indeed, if there hadn't been good international cooperation around with the authorities in South Africa and good testing infrastructure, then the Omicron variant would have had less early warning of the Omicron variant than we actually had. I'll maybe invite Professor Leach to add anything to that, and then perhaps Dominic Munro as well, on the judgments that will be made.
Professor Leach, I don't know if you can hear me, but I think you're on mute.
I'm not.
Okay, sorry. We can hear you now. Thank you.
Oh, can you hear me now? Yes. Somebody turn me up.
Yes.
So I just said good morning, that was all. And thank you for allowing me to come in virtually. It helped logistically significantly this morning, so I appreciate that. DFM covered it very well. You need testing for four reasons. You need to surveil, you need to treat, so you need to know what disease it is you're treating, so you have to test before you treat. You need to know what's happening in high-risk institutions, prisons, social care homes, hospitals, and you need to know how to manage outbreaks, whether that's a chicken factory or a school or wherever else. The question is how you do that. And the end point for all Western European countries is the same. We will test less. You don't test for flu in your own home, but we do test for flu in hospitals. And that's where we're all headed. And we hope to be headed there relatively soon, but we don't know if we're going there. And that's why our advice to the Deputy First Minister and the First Minister was to maintain the testing regime as it is presently, with one principal change, which is the removal of daily or every time you have a social event, asymptomatic testing, to move that to twice weekly, which is what we did before Omicron. And we will continue to monitor the pandemic, but at 1 in 25 cases in the population just now, so every 100 people, there are four positives. We think it is too early to remove that level of protection where you might put others at risk. I just heard this morning of a wedding of 120 people with 30 positives within a few days of that 120. So keeping the positives out of those events and out of cinemas and out of care homes and out of public transport is still a crucial part of our protection. But as prevalence falls, you can adjust your testing regime. And that's exactly the advice we'll give as we hope prevalence falls. But it's not showing signs of doing that, I'm afraid, very quickly.
Thank you. Can I bring in Mr. Munro?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. So just not much more to add to what the Deputy First Minister and Professor Leach have said. But coming back to your question, and putting it in the context of future threats, I think the two key parameters that we'll need to know with any new variant are how much more severe it is than the current strains that are dominant in Scotland and how much more transmissible it is. So whatever the arrangements for testing that we have in place going forwards, and both the Deputy First Minister and Professor Leach have set them out, we need to be able to ascertain those two things and quickly. So we need to ensure that the infrastructure that we have going forward, and that could be in the form of targeted PCR testing, wastewater sampling, a sufficient ONS infection survey, enables us to get that kind of data to be able to ascertain severity and transmissibility quickly. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I'll move on to my next question. I think the announcement of some of the restrictions in March, as I've already said, is very welcome. But there will be a lot of people that have concerns, particularly our most vulnerable, perhaps, that have been on the high risk list during the pandemic. What measures will the government take to ensure that our most vulnerable, people on the high risk, still feel supported as we move on to the next stage?
I think this is a vital issue, Convener, because I quite understand the appetite on the part of individuals to return to something like normal life, but there are some in our society who are frankly terrified by that prospect in the light of COVID. And the first thing I think we have to do is be respectful of their views and their concerns and to understand the anxiety that they face. That is why we have taken the gradual approach that we've taken. We've tried to do that in a measured way to ensure that we try to build as much resilience as we can within the population. So vaccination is critical to help us in that journey. Of course, there are some people who are vulnerable who cannot get vaccinated for entirely understandable clinical reasons, which increases their anxiety further. So vaccination is critical to building resilience. There are routine measures where, although on the 21st of March, we may remove the legal obligation to wear face coverings in on public transport, we will still be saying to people that it would be advantageous for that to be the case and for it to be a good civic gesture to undertake to protect other people. And for those who are very vulnerable, we want to make sure that they have got access to the clinical support that they will require. So individuals who, for example, are immunosuppressed, had communication from the chief medical officer that there are antivirals that would be available to them should they be, because of their clinical vulnerability, that they should access. There is mental health support that we would want to make available to people to support them in their anxiety. And in general, work to make sure that people have the support they require, which recognises the fact that the relaxation of restrictions is not universally welcomed within our society, and we ignore the anxieties and the fears of individuals in our society at our peril.
Thank you. If I can move on to next question from Murdo Fraser, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Deputy First Minister and colleagues. I suppose my first question really is a very neat follow-on from the question that the Convener has just asked. And that is, we've seen a move now from the Scottish Government, which was announced by the First Minister on Tuesday, to move away from legal restrictions towards a situation where we're relying increasingly on personal responsibility and individuals complying with public health guidance, which is very much in tune with what's happened elsewhere in the United Kingdom. First of all, the Welsh Government announced this, then the Northern Irish Government, and the Prime Minister announced the same for England on Monday, albeit on slightly different timescales. So is it now the assessment of the Scottish Government that the public are in a place where they will in the main comply with public health guidance without it being required to be set in law that they behave in a particular way?
That will be our general assumption in relation to the management of the pandemic, but we have to make sure that we have the legal capacity in place and the statutory capacity in place to be able to respond to a deteriorating situation, should that be the situation that we face.
Well, thank you for that response. I mean, I think we have seen, for example, with the discussion there's been around the rules on self-isolation this week, that the Scottish public have complied very well with the public health guidance. When the Prime Minister announced that the self-isolation rules for England would be dropped, there was a lot of criticism of him being made in some quarters. Some people seemed oblivious to the fact that in Scotland there's never been a legal requirement to self-isolate following a positive test, except in the very limited circumstances of international travellers. So I think we are in a good place in terms of the public. But the reason I ask the question, as you can imagine, is we have an instrument to consider shortly on extending the extraordinary powers that the Scottish Government has for a further 6 months. And given that we know the Scottish public respond very well to public health advice, why can't we just trust people to follow the advice, because we know they will do that, rather than having these legal powers continuing?
Because we may face a deteriorating situation and we may have to take some more severe action. I hope we don't have to, but we may have to. I've rehearsed with this committee before that on one Tuesday morning in November, the Cabinet thought that the pandemic was pretty stable, that we could look forward to a pretty straightforward Christmas. And 48 hours later, Michael Matheson was on a call with the United Kingdom government applying travel restrictions on South Africa and various other African countries because Omicron had descended upon us. And bluntly, Omicron was the variant of the virus that came closest to tipping over Scotland's National Health Service, and it came very close. That all happened in the space of 48 hours. So I can't predict what lies ahead, but I have sat in Parliament, in parliaments for now nearly 25 years, and I've listened to members of Parliament rightly demand that the statute book is capable of dealing with situations that we face. And at this moment, with all the history we've had in the last 2 years, I simply want to make sure that Scotland has a statute book that can be used, if it needs to be used, to protect the public. And I stress the word can be used. Not must be or will be, but can be used. Because I suspect I might be exposed to a good amount of criticism for not foreseeing this and not foreseeing that. So in this particular situation, the government is deciding to try to foresee some of the difficulties we might face and put in place a statute book that gives us the ability to respond in a way that we hope we don't have to respond, but may have to respond.
Okay. I suspect we may have to just agree to disagree on this particular point.
I suspect on this particular theme, Mr. Fraser, we may just have to.
Thank you. I have time for one more question, Convener. I was looking at the ONS statistics this morning, which are suggesting that although there is a downward trend in terms of infections across the rest of the UK, in Scotland that is not the case. So the latest figures seem to show that we have an infection rate of 1 in 20 in Scotland, 1 in 25 in England, and 1 in 30 in Wales. Now, that would seem to suggest that despite the fact we've had more legal restrictions in Scotland over the past few months compared to other parts of the UK, England in particular, that hasn't had a beneficial impact on the case rate. I'm sure you saw there was a study in the Financial Times, I think 2 weeks ago, that analysed the figures for the last 6 months, which suggested that, again, despite the fact there were more restrictions in place in Scotland, including around wearing face masks in certain settings, the fact was that there was no beneficial outcome. In fact, the Financial Times was suggesting that the rate of death in Scotland from coronavirus was higher than the rest of the UK. So does that not suggest that the Scottish Government's approach in having more restrictions has not delivered better outcomes than elsewhere?
No. I think I'm obviously aware of the ONS infection survey data this morning. I think if my memory serves me right, and I stand to be correct in this, this is the first week of the survey for certainly since the onset of Omicron, in which the incidence ratio in Scotland has been at a poorer level than England and other parts, but certainly against the English comparison may well be different in relation to some parts of Wales where of course there have been other restrictions. So I think this is the first occasion on which that has been the case. The Financial Times assessment, I think, raises a lot of questions because, essentially, the death rate in Scotland, and I hate to talk in this kind of language, but it's been put to me, so I have to do it, the death rate in Scotland has been comparatively lower than the death rate in England throughout the pandemic. So I'm not quite sure where the Financial Times gets its conclusions from. I think what's important is that we take measures that we consider to be proportionate and appropriate. And the Scottish Government has done that throughout. with the objective of protecting the public. And if the position in Scotland had been any more serious than it has already been, and it has been serious, then I'm quite sure that there would be many people queuing up to demand the Scottish Government take stronger action. Indeed, some people have demanded the Scottish Government take even stronger action than it's taken. And people would be free, obviously, to make those arguments. But, you know, we have to make a balanced set of judgments, and protecting the public has been at the heart of those judgments.
Okay. Thank you. I'd love to pursue these issues further, but I fear we're out of time.
Thank you. I'm going to go this way, this time to John Mason, please.
Thanks very much, Convener. We continue to have a problem with misinformation and people who are either COVID sceptic or vaccine sceptic. And I understand some of the data that has been produced has been misused or misquoted and twisted. And as a result, Public Health Scotland are not going to continue publishing some of the figures. There was an interesting article by Helen McArdle in Saturday's Herald, which I frankly struggled to understand. So, I mean, can you clarify what the problem was? I think it may have been to do with the unvaccinated population and how they are counted. But, you know, can you clarify why that data is not solid and why it's not being published?
Perhaps invite Professor Leach to come in on this particular point, or we may have to write to the committee on this point.
I'm not entirely clear what that is, so I think writing might be the best idea. I was going to say guess, never say guess in front of the Deputy First Minister or a parliamentary committee, but my best thinking here is that one of the translational challenges in the vaccinated and hospitalisation data is, why does it look as though more vaccinated people are in hospital than unvaccinated people are in hospital? And that's a good question. The reason why is the vast majority of the country are vaccinated. And therefore, you still end up with more vaccinated people in hospital because your denominator is so huge compared to the unvaccinated small numbers of people. However, if you look at it proportionately, so the proportion of people who are vaccinated who end up in hospital compared to the proportion of unvaccinated people who end up in hospital, you see a stark difference. And that shows globally that vaccinations stop hospital admissions, they stop ICU, and they stop deaths. Not in their tracks, of course. They don't reduce it to zero, but they reduce it significantly. And therefore, when you go to intensive care, as I did this week in the Queen Elizabeth Hospital, then you are much more likely to see unvaccinated proportionately in that intensive care unit. But I'll look at Helen McArdle's article and we'll get back to you on the specifics. But I imagine that's what it was.
Yes, I think that was area it was touching on. I mean, there was also mention of ghost patients. I understand that the population who are registered with the GP is actually higher than the population.
Yes, that's correct.
Seems to be another part of it.
I think if Mr. Mason will understand that, although I try my best to keep across all newspaper articles, I don't read every one of them. If that was the case, I would be doing nothing else in life. So if the committee will forgive me, we'll write to the convener with a response on that point.
That's fine. No, I think Professor Leach's answer did deal with the actual problem, so that is helpful to get that on the record. I mean, the second area I wanted to touch on was vaccines, and we're obviously expanding that slightly, and some people are getting a fourth or second booster vaccine. Can you give us any indication where that might be going? Are we going to go right through the population from the oldest to the youngest again, or would annual boosters wait till the autumn for kind of the under 75s?
I'm going into territory here where I'm speculating. What we do know is that the JCVI advice that we've received will result in us issuing vaccination appointments to all 5 to 11-year-olds very shortly. We'll start that in mid-March to issue, and we'll do most of that around about the Easter holidays. An additional booster will be provided to care home residents, those over 75, and those over 12 who are immunosuppressed. So, you know, that's going to dominate the spring and the period towards the summer. I think that probably makes it likely that we are heading towards a booster programme in the autumn, but obviously we will await GCVI advice on that particular question. But I think we will be moving into a period, assuming there is no substantive deterioration in the situation, where we will be relying upon vaccination to provide us with effective resilience.
Okay, thank you. My next one was just on testing. That's been mentioned already, but I mean, if we don't get funding from the UK, or if the UK does not fund the testing kits, etc., is that going to seriously curtail what we can do?
Obviously, we've got judgments to make about what will be the nature of the programme, the testing programme that we can take forward, and it is informed by the decisions that are taken by the United Kingdom government, because clearly the financial arrangements that support an expansive testing programme, if curtailed, will have an effect on our ability to deliver such a programme. So we have to pursue the detail of the United Kingdom government announcement that was made earlier this week. I think it was pretty obvious that it was a tense set of discussions within the UK government, some might call it chaotic, that led to the announcements on Monday. That has not provided us with particular clarity about their intentions. We're now seeking that, and that will inform the testing programme that we come out. But what I would assure Mr Mason and the committee about is that the points that Professor Leach and I put on the record in our responses to the convener will very much inform the formulation of the plan that the government puts in place to enable that to be the case.
Okay, thanks. And my final point, if I may, is looking at the strategic framework going forward. I think there is a little bit of mention of Malawi, Zambia and Rwanda and what we can maybe do for them. Can you just say anything about what we might do for them?
Well, we are obviously working closely with the long-standing relationships that we have with these countries to play our part responsibly to support the vaccination programmes that are underway there. I think we accept as a government the importance of ensuring that we fulfil our international obligations to ensure that the whole world is protected from COVID, because only by the whole world being protected from COVID do we have as much assurance and security as we possibly can do. And that will be our cooperation will be to that end to achieve that objective.
Thanks very much.
Can I bring in Brian Whittle, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Deputy First Minister and your colleagues. I'm going to take the opportunity here, if I could, to extend the conversation we had with our previous panel around, looking at lessons learned and what we can do in the future. I think some of the submissions, or most of the submissions we had from the experts, were the word anecdotal in terms of collection of data and what's happening out there appeared a lot within their submissions. Especially around, what's happening around non-COVID-related conditions and deaths from other conditions. It says here may have increased, but they're not aware of any data to support this. And I think, this really extends work that was done in the Health and Sport Committee in the last term around collection of data. And then, very fortunately, one of the experts this morning raised the issue of the IT system that's currently available within the NHS, and the words clunky came out. There was three different systems that the NHS worked with just now, and that it would be really beneficial looking ahead if one of the investments that was made was delivering an IT system that allowed proper collection of appropriate data and deployment of that data. And I think COVID has taught us that data is incredibly important. And I wonder, Deputy First Minister, is this something that I know the government were looking at this in the previous term. I wonder where we are with the development of a new IT system, potentially for the NHS.
The first observation I'd make on Mr Whittle's question is that, in a sense, Mr Whittle makes one of the fundamental points I was making in my response to Mr Fraser, that it is important to deduce lessons from the pandemic and apply them and learn them where we believe there are important lessons to be learned. And I happen to take that view about the statutory framework, and Mr. Whittle has put into me an entirely legitimate point in relation to data and IT. I think fundamentally Scotland has been very well served by some critical decisions that were made a long time ago about the unique identifier of the CHI number, mm-hmm. which has essentially acted as the foundation for the administration of healthcare within Scotland, based around the individual, enabling the information and the records of individuals to be accessed appropriately to ensure the delivery of quality healthcare for that individual. So I think that that's been a really strong foundation of our systems, but of course, with every development that comes along, there are extra pressures put on that core system. And of course, COVID has put many data demands onto the system, particularly around about vaccination records and all that has gone with issues of that type. So the government has been looking for and has been taking active steps to ensure that the approach to the delivery of digital care has been strong within Scotland. I think it's got ever stronger during the course of the pandemic. And the development of appropriate information technology capability to ensure that we can meet the needs of individuals, that we identify those needs and we meet those needs, lies at the heart of the system. So the government will be working closely with health boards on this question to ensure that the foundations of our IT system are kept up to date to ensure that we meet the needs of individuals.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. But I think there was definitely frustration vented this morning with healthcare professionals around things like the interface between primary and secondary care being unable to access primary care data when a patient presents. And I think to me this is an area that I worked in pre-Parliament, and it's something that interests me, this ability to port that kind of information, that kind of data. And I think that what COVID has done is exacerbated the issue and highlighted the issue. And looking ahead, as you said, we need the lessons learned, as you said, Deputy First Minister, there is an opportunity here, a very good opportunity here, to look at how and what data is collected and how that is accessed. And it does fundamentally require an IT system that's universally applicable across the whole of the country. That isn't the case at the moment. And again, as I said, I'm just wondering where we are with the development of that kind of structure.
I think I'd have to. I would want to go and have a look at exactly the circumstances that the clinicians were raising with the committee this morning. Certainly, my understanding is that throughout the National Health Service, there is the capacity and capability to access critical information about the healthcare of each individual. And that's why I made reference to the CHI number, because that's what underpins and drives the system. So I would want to understand a bit better some of the deficiencies that have been highlighted. But in principle, the availability of data and the necessity to collect the appropriate data within our healthcare systems is something that, with which I agree with the points Mr. Whittle puts to me. And to have a system that can be accessed in all different spheres of the health service is an important provision as well. So I'm very happy to look at those issues, to look at the particular points raised by the clinicians this morning, I will encourage the Health Secretary to look at these questions and to determine what further action requires to be taken.
Yeah, I think just to finish on this particular point, I'll finish here, is that, you know, if you look back, I would encourage the Deputy First Minister and the Health Cabinet Secretary to look back at the work that was done by the Health Support Committee in the last term, and again, listen to the evidence this morning. The situation that you described there is, you know, this sort of universality of access is not the case in Scotland. If you input your data in Glasgow, somebody in Edinburgh can't access it. If you happen to be over here, you have to re-input that. So look, we're getting into an area here, but I do think this is a I'm just saying it's not a criticism, but I think there's an opportunity here to look at a whole a system-wide change that would be to the huge benefit of our population and to our NHS workers.
Yeah. It's the characterisation that Mr. Puddle puts to me is not my understanding of the situation, but I'll go away and look at it again. But I think there is accessibility for critical information. It's perhaps not all information, I accept that, but I'll certainly look at the issues that Mr. Whittle raises and encourage the Health Secretary to do so.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can I bring in Jim Fairley, please?
Thank you, Convener. I'll just reiterate what Mr. Whittle has just said. That's clearly the message that came across from this morning, is that you can't follow a patient regardless. If it goes from one department to another, that information isn't following them, so it's just to look at that, because my understanding was that it could right across the country, and it, from what we're getting this morning, that's not the case. there's so many things I'd like to talk to you about, however. Testing.
It's part of our relationship.
I know. What is the WHO advice on testing at this stage, given where we are in the pandemic?
I'll come specifically to Professor Leach on that point, but the World Health Organization advice to us at this stage in the pandemic in general is to take care and not to consider that everything is over and done with. The World Health Organization are still, so the position the Scottish Government has taken on, for example, continued use of face coverings as a mandatory provision, is an approach in line with the guidance from the World Health Organization. The World Health Organization will encourage us to maintain a testing infrastructure that enables us to identify what is the prevalence of the virus in our own society and what can we contribute to an international understanding of the virus by virtue of the information that we collect and the experience that we have. Now, when it comes to specific measures and restrictions, the World Health Organization may set out what they think to be desirable. We as a government have to judge whether that is proportionate, because we have to be satisfied that we could withstand legal challenge to any of the decisions that we take. But generally, the advice from the World Health Organization is to take care at this rather pivotal moment in the pandemic. But I'll come to Professor Leach for that on the specific point on WHO advice on testing.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. And very briefly, I won't go down the digital health tunnel, but I would commend to the committee the October update to NHS Scotland's Digital Health and Care Strategy, which sets out both the present position and the plans for the future. They may want to consider that in deeper detail, and the Health and Support Committee certainly will. My four categories, Mr. Fairley, come directly from the WHO's advice. Mr. Swinney is correct that the fundamentals are that you should take it cautiously. The next variant, of which there will be one, will either come from a highly vaccinated country with a high prevalence, which is what we have, or an unvaccinated country. So the virus will either find a way through vaccines, and if it has high prevalence, it gets more opportunity to do that, or it will find a way of transmitting in an unvaccinated community. So vaccine squeeze, what the virologists call it, so the virus will find a way to get new people. So that means you need to do surveillance, and that requires genetic surveillance, so you need PCR testing for that, and you need to do that, if you can, randomly across the country, like the ONS survey, but also for those with symptoms. You need to do high-risk locations, you need to have capability to manage outbreaks, and you need to know who to treat. Because as the therapeutics improve, you need to know who to give the therapeutics to. It's a fairly basic clinical formula. So does this person have COVID? So should I give them COVID medication? Or does this person have something else for which they would have different medication? So in order to make that decision, clinicians need testing. Now, traditionally, we do that once they reach healthcare. The challenge with this disease is because of the great therapeutics we're now developing, many of them are helpful before you reach healthcare, before you're sick enough to need traditional medication. It may be that antivirals could stop the heart transplant patient or the 85-year-old reaching healthcare at all. So therefore, you have to move testing up the chain, do it earlier, and then you get treatment options coming from that. That's what the WHO say you should do, and that's the advice we're giving to the Scottish Government.
Okay, the point I'm trying to get to is how we surveil in order to make sure that if there is something moving about in our community, that we catch it as early as possible. Is the current system, the current system we have in place, we know is sufficient? Is what we are moving to going to be sufficient?
Well, that's essentially the discussions that we are taking forward as part of the formulation of the testing transition plan, because I think it has to be accepted that we cannot sustain the level of testing infrastructure that we have had in place for most of the last 2 years. But we cannot have none in place. And one of the lessons of the start of the outbreak, indeed, there's a really interesting global point on this. Many of the Asian countries have been able to withstand COVID to a greater extent because of their experience on the SARS-related viruses over the past. They have always maintained a much greater testing capacity and capability than ordinarily was the case in Western countries. Now, we might not go to those levels, but we certainly have to go some way towards them to maintain surveillance. So the debate that we've got to have is on the question of sufficiency. We believe a sufficiently credible and capable ONS survey is vital to enable us to be able to be properly prepared. We have got to have a level of testing infrastructure that enables us to detect and identify any new strains, and we have got to have a capacity to be able to identify any emerging issues within individual populations. So, for example, Dominic Munro made the point about wastewater sampling. This is actually a very good way of determining the parts of the country where there may be, comparatively speaking, more incidence and presence of the virus, which can be undertaken through wastewater sampling, and that will be sustained by the Scottish Government on an ongoing basis. So there's a variety. So there isn't a definitive answer today to Mr. Fairley's question. It's a very important and legitimate question, but over the course of the next few months, we will have to answer that question satisfactorily as to what should be the level of capacity we retain in place.
Okay, thank you. One very, very quick
one,
if possible.
I'm sorry, Mr. Fairley, we're running out of time. Alex Raleigh, please.
Yeah, there is a thing called political balance, isn't there? Can I say firstly that I do not think that it's unreasonable to look for an extension of powers for another period of time, given where we are. If you were saying you wanted these powers forevermore, that would be a different matter. But I think given where we are right now, and that's why I welcome the announcement this week that there's work now going to be done on future pandemics. Professor Leach talks about possible variants, and I think I worry that, you know, we're starting to get to a point where everybody thinks this is over and we can get back to some kind of normality. But in terms of the work and the reports that are coming in the spring, are you looking at a proposal for how we prepare and plan Scotland-wide? Or when you say you're talking to local authorities, are we looking at regional approaches across Scotland so that at a regional level they're prepared? And if I can just say to that, the evidence we had this morning, part of that for the Royal College of GPs, was that 7 years on for the incorporation of health and social care into the IGBs, it's a hit or a miss at the local level as to whether you've got joined up services, mental health services, social work services, all working at a GP level. So we don't seem to, it's fine to have big central plans, but we don't seem to actually be able to get that through onto the ground and have a decentralised system of governance in place to deliver.
Well, first of all, I'm grateful to hear that Mr Rowley has taken his usual rational and considered approach to the regulatory infrastructure, which I very much welcome. I look forward to that being shared universally across the committee. On the substantive point of Mr Rowley's question, I do very much agree with his sentiment that there is a danger that people think this is all over and done with. And it's not. And I know I sound like a broken record about my Omicron example, but you know these things can happen really quite quickly. And we don't know the extent to which, as international travel takes off again to a greater extent, how quickly these variants may be able to spread across the world. So there's absolutely legitimate points here. Now, on the preparedness question, Mr Rowley is correct. We are now undertaking further work on future pandemic preparation. That has to be an all-Scotland approach. And that's not an argument to say it's just got to be done at national level. It's an all-Scotland approach. It's got to involve our resilience partnerships in every part of the country. Mr Rowley will be familiar from his long experience in Fife of the role of the local authority as a key part of the resilience partnership at local level, working with the health board, the police, fire and rescue service and various other players who we turn to and rely upon, as we have relied upon during the pandemic, to be able to deliver an appropriate response. Indeed, we've been relying on them very much about stormy weather as well. So those local resilience arrangements have got to be effective. So we've got to engage them. I meet regularly with the Scottish Resilience Partnership, which brings together these local resilience partnerships where we reflect on what are the current threats, what are the challenges we face, how do we respond to them, what's the learning we can deduce in every part of the country. So all of that is undertaken and valid, and we should be focused on pandemic preparation. I think if I was to reflect on the last number of years, when we've looked at an annual stock take of what are the resilience threats that we face Scotland, that would face Scotland. Yes, a pandemic has always been right up there, but you sit there waiting for it to happen, but stormy weather comes very frequently, as we know, and you know flooding comes frequently, and various other things. So it's important that we have that foresighting capability. Now, Mr. Rowley goes on to raise, I think, a really fundamental issue, and it's an issue relevant to the debate around the National Care Service, because he is absolutely correct. There are, and I think he and I will be able to agree on this point, there are variations in the quality of the delivery of care around the country. The question is, what do we do about that? Because currently, I would contend, the arrangements that we have in place do not provide the assurance that in every part of the country, every individual member of the public who needs care services is able to get the sufficient quality and extent of those services. And I think the government's view is, and this came from the research undertaken by the Feely Review, that that would be best addressed by the establishment of a National Care Service. And that's an issue Parliament will obviously have extensive discussions on in the foreseeable future. But I think the point I want to emphasise clearly to the committee is that I acknowledge the importance of every member of the public, regardless of where they live, being able to rely upon quality care service and quality care experience.
So we've saw this week that we've got 1 in 8 people in Scotland are on an NHS waiting list. I was asking the health professionals earlier around what data is available. In fact, I think Professor Leach told me a few weeks ago that most of the data should be available on this. But to understand the knock-on effect, so the example I gave this morning is two constituents both needing a hip replacement, both suffering for that. One is able to get £15,500 together and go to get it done privately, and that's them sorted. The other cannot afford that, The knock-on effect that's having on that person's mental health, the knock-on effect it's having elsewhere. So in terms of these waiting lists, what we're actually going to do, is there regional planning going in, health board by health board? How are we going to get these waiting lists down, and how are we going to address the knock-on effects that these unacceptable waiting times are having on people's health and wellbeing?
We've had discussions in this committee and indeed across Parliament on countless occasions. Mr Whittle has consistently questioned me on this question of the impact on people from non-COVID health harms. And these are absolutely legitimate questions. And I'd be the first to acknowledge that waiting lists are larger and longer than they were before the pandemic, but that is a direct result of the pandemic. Now, there's no health board in the country that wants to get into a position as early as possible to be able to tackle these waiting lists. There's no health board in the country wants to put off tackling these waiting lists. But obviously, we have to be mindful of the presence and the prevalence of COVID. Although we've seen a fall in COVID admissions to hospitals in general in the course of the last few weeks, to our unease, COVID admissions are rising again, and the number of people in hospital with COVID is rising again, unfortunately. So I would assure the committee, and this is part of the NHS recovery plan, it's also the inherent in the investment the government is making in the elective treatment centres, that we are anxious to expand the capacity to be able to address the very issue that Mr Rowley fairly puts to me, that members of the public who are suffering pain, need a hip replacement, can within a reasonable timescale be able to expect that they can have that treatment undertaken.
But should we not be saying to each health board that they need to identify exactly what the demands are in their area and start to bring forward some kind of proposal on how they're going to do that?
Well, that's what I would contend the NHS recovery plan does, because it focuses entirely on that issue of making up for the treatment that has been lost because of COVID. And each health board is under an obligation with a plan that they've had to submit to the health secretary about how they're going to go about doing that. And obviously, we are keen to make sure we make as swift and early progress as we possibly can do on advancing that treatment.
Good. Thank you. I'm sorry, I've run out of time for this part of the agenda. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item, and I'd like to thank the Deputy First Minister and his officials for their evidence today. I now move on to the third agenda item, which is consideration of the motion for the Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Act No. 4, Regulations 2022. Members will be aware that we will take the motion on the other two instruments listed under agenda item 2 at a future meeting once the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee has reported on them. Deputy First Minister, would you like to make any further remarks on this SSI before we take the motion?
I think it would help if I put some comments on the record about these regulations. The committee has in its agenda 3 SSIs and a motion to approve the number 4 amendment regulations. These 3 instruments all put back the date on which the key coronavirus provisions would have expired by default, and thus act to protect our ability to have in place any measures that are considered necessary. The Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Amendment No. 4 Regulations 2022 amend the date on which the Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Regulations 2021 expire from the 28th of February 2022 to the 24th of September 2022. If this expiry date is not changed, the baseline measures will automatically cease on the 28th of February. Although we are starting to take steps to remove the baseline measures, regulation shared with the committee yesterday will remove the COVID certification scheme from the regulations. It is important that the other baseline measures can remain in place after the 28th of February to support our review of the baseline measures on the basis of the latest data. We do expect that the other legal requirements will be converted to guidance on the 21st of March, but as the First Minister said on Tuesday, this is subject to there being no significant adverse developments in the course of the virus. The Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Directions by Local Authorities Scotland Amendments Regulations 2022 amend the date on which the Health Protection Coronavirus Restrictions Directions by Local Authorities Scotland Regulations 2020 expire from the 25th of March 2022 to the 24th of September 2022. The directions regulations will continue to be reviewed every 42 days as is required by the regulations. Keeping these regulations in place for a longer period of time will support local outbreak management of coronavirus. Local action to control or close premises or businesses at the centre of an outbreak can, in many cases, be the most effective and proportionate response. The Coronavirus Act 2020 Alteration of Expiry Date Scotland Regulations 2022 extend the expiry date of five provisions within the UK Coronavirus Act for a further 6 months until the 24th of September. Without these regulations, those provisions would otherwise expire automatically on the 24th of March, alongside the majority of the Act's provisions. These provisions being retained for a further 6 months relate to the remote registration of deaths and stillbirths, removing the requirement for vaccinations and immunisations to be delivered by or under the direction of a medical practitioner, powers for Scottish ministers to give either boarding or student accommodation directions, which restrict either access or confine occupants, power for ministers to give educational continuity directions and enable education and childcare provision to continue, and powers for ministers to make health protection regulations such as the Health Protection Coronavirus Requirements Scotland Regulations 2021 that were mentioned earlier. All of these provisions are in the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill, which is undergoing scrutiny by this and other relevant committees. The government thinks these particular provisions should be legislated for permanently from September 2022, should the Parliament agree to the alteration of expiry date regulations, and that is, of course, a matter for separate determination by Parliament. The alteration of expiry date regulations have been made under the made affirmative procedure. At the time of laying, our understanding was that this was the only procedure available to us for these regulations. It has since come to our attention, after discussion amongst lawyers, that we could have used the affirmative procedure. However, even with that understanding, we assured that Parliament would have 40 days for scrutiny prior to the regulations coming into force on the 24th of March 2022. Thank you.
Thank you, Deputy President. I now invite you to move motion S6M-03168.
I move the motion in my name, Convener.
Thank you. Can I invite comments from members? Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Convener. I'll comment very briefly, given the time and given we've already rehearsed these arguments in the committee. The instrument before us seeks to extend the extraordinary and emergency powers for a period of 6 months. As I outlined earlier, I think we're now in a place, I think the Scottish Government have more or less conceded this point, where we will be relying in future increasingly upon the good sense of people to follow public health guidance rather than be required to act in particular ways by the law. And I believe the experience we've had over the past 2 years shows people respond very well to public health guidance. So I would suggest that it's not appropriate for these powers to be extended. I believe we should test the good judgment of the Scottish people, who have demonstrated in spades thus far their willingness to comply with public health guidance. For these reasons, I would oppose the instrument before us.
Thank you, Mr. Fraser. Mr. Rowley, would you like to
comment? Yeah, just convener, just briefly, I would say that at this point in time, I do believe that it is proportionate and reasonable for the government to have this extension. We should not take our eye off the fact that we are not through this by any means. For the longer term, that's a different issue, and it's one this committee and other committees will debate, but I don't think it's unreasonable for a six-month extension.
OK, thanks very much. Deputy First Minister, would you like to comment? Oh, sorry, Brian Whittle.
Thank you. I think, Deputy First Minister, I think I remember very vividly the bringing the emergency powers to the chamber, and quite rightly you had universal support across the chamber for those emergency powers for the situation that you faced at the time. But yourself and the First Minister have also said that these powers would only be appropriate and kept for the minimum amount of time possible, and they would go back to parliamentary scrutiny as quickly as possible. And I do think, I remember how quickly the emergency powers were brought into being, how they were brought in front of the Parliament and voted on. And as my colleague Murdo Fraser says, we're in a different time now. And I think that the governments shouldn't hold these kind of powers unless absolutely necessary. And I think, given that you could bring this back before Parliament and given that these emergency powers could be reinstated very quickly if required, I have to say that along with my colleague, I'm going to have to oppose.
Thank you very much. John Mason, can I bring you in, please?
Thank you very much. Yes, just briefly to respond to that, I think that there is in people's thinking a little bit of a difference between what is legal and what is just guidance, despite what Murdo Fraser says about people's good sense. I was down in England last week where it tends to be more guidance and people were not really adhering to a lot of the guidance. So I think it's just too early to lift this. I agree we don't want legislation in place any longer than it needs to be, but I think we're just a little bit too early to change direction. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Fairley, would you like to come in?
Yeah. Just in terms of the ability to be able to actually say, no, this is what's going to happen, because sometimes people just put their hands and say, no, we're not doing it anymore. I think the government has to have the ability to be able to say, no, this is going to happen because of whatever the circumstances should be. And we are far, far away from being out of this. And I know I may be one of the more cautious ones on this committee, but as far as I'm concerned, until we're through it, we're through it. We're not through it. And therefore, it's utterly essential that the government has the powers to be able to take proportionate action.
Thank you, Mr. Fairley. Deputy First Minister, can I ask you to respond to any of the contributions?
Thank you, Convener. I acknowledge that there is a difference of opinion amongst members on the issue here. I think the point that I made in my earlier response is that I believe there is a duty in the government to have in place a statute book that can enable us to respond to the circumstances that we face. Colleagues have indicated that there are challenges likely to be ahead for us. I think the measures that are in place are measures that have appropriate safeguards. There is no obligation to use these measures. The obligation, I think, for us as parliamentarians is to have a statute book in place that can respond to the challenges we face. To Mr. Whittle's point, I would say a criticism of Parliament, and indeed I've heard this criticism been made, is that we didn't have the necessary legislation in place to deal with the pandemic, a pandemic scenario. And if we are going to prepare properly for these things, we have to make sure that we've got the legislation in place with the appropriate safeguards. And I would reiterate that although these provisions will extend the regulatory infrastructure in place, it does not oblige the government to use them in all circumstances. In relation to the number four regulations, there is a necessity if we want to continue the legal obligation to wear face coverings in public transport and public places to the 21st of March. That has to be put into place today, or that would fall on the 28th of February. So certainly in that short term, I would appeal to colleagues to support the regulations that will be the subject of a vote today. But there are obviously two other instruments that will be subject to discussion in due course.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. Members are not agreed, so there will be a division. We will now move to a vote on motion S6M-03168. Can I ask those members who agree with the motion to raise their hand? Alex Rowley, Jim Fairley, John Mason, and myself, Ms. Kavina. And can I ask members who are not agreed to the motion to raise their hands? Murdo Fraser and Brian Whittle. So the result is 4 for yes and 2 for no. Therefore, the motion is agreed to. The committee will publish a report to the Parliament setting out our decision on the statutory instrument considered in this agenda item in due course. That concludes our consideration of this agenda item. And